Welcome to this, I think it's the last session. So about me, my name is Marco Hugentobler. I'm a co-owner of the company SourcePol. We are based in the center of Zurich, Switzerland, and we are doing a lot of development in QGIS, GDAL. We are supporting PostGIS, and we are also doing web development and general Linux services. So, from desktop to spatial data infrastructure with QGIS. Actually, that one. Once a person or a company starts doing GIS, it's usually with a set of shapefiles and a desktop GIS. Yeah. After all these years, it's still like that. Yeah. So, fortunately, after all these years, this desktop GIS is most likely QGIS and not any other product anymore. So, the topic of my talk is, how do we get from this set of shapefiles to a lean geodata infrastructure around the desktop GIS? So once people deal with shapefiles, that's great. However, it starts to be a problem if several people are collaborating, several people are editing the same data set, the same file. So usually going from desktop GIS to a geodata infrastructure, first step is to have a database and several users doing edits or accessing this database. So coming from QGIS, what can we use as a database system? This is quite an easy choice. QGIS supports several spatial databases like PostGIS, Oracle Spatial, SQL Server. However, my advice, if you don't need to use any of the last two databases, go with PostGIS. The reason is simple. PostGIS is the data source which is best supported by QGIS. So QGIS has a set of drivers accessing the data sources, and the best maintained driver is the PostGIS driver. It's also very well tested and used in production by many companies and users. So that was the database, quite easy. Now, the next thing that people want, if they come from desktop GIS, want to go to infrastructure, then they say, okay, now we have a database, we can collaborate, we can editing. Now, next thing we need is to have a web map. What do we need here? So server-side, we need web map comes usually with HTTP or HTTPS. So components that we use is we need some sort of web server that does all the HTTP, HTTPS handling, certificates, user authentication, and so on. And behind that, we have a WMS server that is generating the images. WMS server does not know anything about HTTP, just produces the image and sends it to the back via the web server and accesses the database. And we of course also need a web client, and so going through all the components, if we come from QGIS desktop, the first choice for a WMS server is of course QGIS server. I have to say that in theory you can use any WMS server since it's a standard. That's in theory. However, in practice, QGIS server has some nice extension that makes it very handy to use it for web maps. So the first is the web-based printing. So once you create like a set of print composers in QGIS, these print composers will also be available from the WMS server, And so you can, we have like a new request called getPrint, and getPrint takes as argument a template name and a few other things, and it delivers back a PDF, and the PDF looks exactly like that what you created in QGIS desktop. And these print templates can be very, can have many elements, so it really saves a lot of time to use this getPrint request instead of going with a software where you have to write like large template files. The first one. Second extension that QGIS Server has, it has even more, but these are the most important ones, is the redlining. Redlining, so people can do some drawing on the web client, and the web client sends this information to the server, and the WMS server prints it to the web map. Now, sometimes people think, okay, we can do that client side, that's easy. However, we decided to render it server-side, because if you do web-based printing, you normally want to have the redlining also on the print, and if it's only client-side, then you won't have it in the print. Another extension is the selection. In desktop.js, you can select elements, they will be highlighted and so on. So we also have like an argument and selection equals, and then you give number of give you IDs, and it will be highlighted on server side on the image. Next extension is QGIS Server allows to give like external services, so your client can request a map, and additionally to the layers that are predefined on the server, you can say, I want other WMS or WMTS layers. So this is also quite nice, because usually external WMS layers, they usually come directly to the web map. However, if we do printing with QGIS Server, you want them to have cascaded. So this is a very handy way to handle that flexible. Okay, that was the WMS server. Now the web server, here we can, if we are using QGIS Server, then we can use any web server supporting the fast CGI protocol. Most popular ones are Apache, Nginx, but there are also LightTTPD or IIS. Normally I used to think that whatever web server you use, it doesn't matter. However, for this conference I made a little test if it does matter or not, and I found out it matters. So what I did was I compared the Apache MODFCGID, that's what people normally use. I compared that with Nginx FCGI, so both with a QGIS server. And the test that I was running was set up with a similar system. Maybe you remember this WMS benchmarks from Phosphor G 2010 and 2011. So we there set up some tools to generate these benchmarks. And the benchmark is done with this JMeter tool, and the JMeter tool sends a number of requests. And first it sends one parallel request, then two, then four, then 8, 16, 32, and 64. Total 2,152 requests. And the data set I used was this, how do you say that in English? It's like the like a cadastral WMS from Switzerland. You see, it's like a canton which has a lot of mountains, so in the valley the WMS server has to render a bit more, and somewhere on the mountain it's not so densely. So results are, so for the total of 2,152 requests with Apache MODFCGID, it took 89 seconds, and with Nginx it took longer. Both with 16 processes, it took on Nginx longer, 97 seconds. And you see like the behavior, So the average request is faster with Apache and also the total duration. However, the slowest requests with Apache grows very large. So I thought this is very interesting because it depends on probably on your use case, what you want to use. So if you, for instance, want to do tile seeding and you want to do that as fast as possible, you probably would go for Apache. And if you have like an interactive web map, then you're probably worried about the poor person who has to wait the longest time, and then you probably would favor Nginx. I, however, have no idea why this is the case, so I don't know the internals of these two modules and us. Now, that was the server side. Now let's come to the client side, the web clients. Also here, you can use any client. However, there are a few clients that really make use of the additional capabilities that QGIS Server offers. So the first one is QGIS Web Client 2. It's a React-based web client. There was yesterday a presentation from my colleague, which was about that. Then there is the GIS Quick web client, which is based on Vue.js. Don't know if that's a correct pronunciation. And then there's a third client. There's the LISMAP web client, which is based on web components. So this is QGIS Web Client 2. It nearly uses all additional possibilities of QGIS Server. So it's possible to use web-based printing, it uses redlining, selection, and it also uses these additional WMS layers as background. This is how the LISMAP web client looks like. And this here is the GIS Quick web client. What I really like about that one is that it has like a table widget, and it's possible to select entries here like you do in desktop GIS. So next element in our stack is a tile cache. So once we see that WMS server is too slow or does not scale enough, then we might decide to have a WMTS server in between, so that caches tiles as images and delivers that. Here we can really use any WMTS client. There's not it's not like in the other cases, it's not such that that client is better with QGIS Server or so on. So you can use. So there are a few. QGIS Server has its own WMTS service. However, the functionality is a bit more limited compared to like map cache from map server or map proxy. Another solution that we sometimes apply in our company is that we don't have a specialized WMTS server, but we have like a generic HTTP cache that delivers the images. Most popular is here is Varnish, and the advantage against specialized WMTS servers is that you don't need to care about tile seeding and so on, so it's just transparent and it caches and you can set the timeout and so on. So there is less administrative tasks with that. So that's all nice. Now we are coming to the last step. That is like the WebGIS platforms, I would call them. So having a database, WMS server, and so on is nice. However, people say, oh, we want that people can publish their projects. We want to administer, like have an administrative interface about users, have access control, all that. So for that we need like an additional layer in between. So I have two solutions for that here. One is a hosted solution called QGIS Cloud from our company. And the second one is this GIS Quick. There was also a talk about that on this conference. So QGIS Cloud, hosted GDI. I have to say it's more than QGIS. It's more than only QGIS in the cloud. It's like a geodata infrastructure in the cloud. And the most important thing is that we have provide like a hosted PostGIS. So the workflow is that there's a plugin in QGIS. So once you have a set of shapefiles, you want the web map and the database, you can upload it to QGIS Cloud. And then you get all database, web server, WMS server, and so on directly with it. This is how it looks. So you can get started by signing up, then they send you an email and you confirm, then you have your account. In QGIS you download the QGIS Cloud plugin, and you see once you have shapefiles you can say upload data and then publish map. And with this step your data goes to the hosted database and you directly have then web map and database. Then the web map looks exactly the same as in the desktop because it's QGIS server serving that. And I also have to say that compared to other cloud solutions, they usually have like an API and the database is behind the API. In QGIS Cloud, this is not the case. You can directly access the PostGIS database with any tool. You can use pgadmin, psql, QGIS, and directly go to the database. So there's a free account for non-commercial, non-governmental use, which has up to 50 megabyte PostGIS database usage. So this is quite handy. And the thing is, once you publish here with the free account, of course your data is private. No one can see your data. However, if you are published with the free account, everyone can see your web map. So for that we have the commercial account called QGIS Cloud Pro, which has more database space and it's possible to protect the web maps by login. Additional database space can then be rented. And soon to come is we will support like editing in the web browser. That is to come in the next weeks, I would say. The next thing I'll show quickly is this GIS Quick. This is now another web platform solution. It's completely open source. It's not hosted. So you have to install that on your machine. And basically it comes as three Docker images. So it's Django based. That's Django, QGIS server, and Nginx in this Docker. So no database. You need to have provide an additional database. And it's also quite nice. People can upload their projects. However, once you have files, then you create a zip and you upload it. So it's also very nice and it's quite easy to get started with. These Dockers, you just clone it from GitHub and then do Docker compose up and it should basically be running, at least as a test instance. So, short summary. Desktop PIs is still very important. However, it needs a geodata infrastructure to collaborate with other users, show it to non-GIS users in the web browser and so on. And we have seen creating a lean GDI with QGIS and some other components is not a hard task. And a hosted solution exists with QGIS Cloud. Thank you.
Okay, so if there are any questions from the room.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. In fact, it's not really a question, it's more a comment. You have said that you need any FCGI web server capable in order to make a QGIS server working. But in fact, since QGIS 3, QGIS server has been rewritten as a Python class, a fully functional Python class. That means you don't need any more FCGI to use QGIS server. You can use it directly in any Python framework. You can use it directly in Flask, directly in Django, directly with Tornado, or any application that will need Python application that will need to access WMS services directly.
Yes, that's true. QGIS
server. It was just a precision that I wanted to bring.
QGIS Server 3 has more Python functionality, and it's like possible to write some Python things to access it. However, if you just install the standard QGIS Server, I think it's still a fast CGI. Oh.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? If there is no question, then we can take a short break till 14:30. So, and then we'll start with the next presentation. Thank you very much.